You have a real gift for putting music in historical context, around political, social forces. And how would you characterize the state of, we'll call it classical music today, if you know what I mean? I mean more than that, but the state of classical music today. And in what kind of historical context would you place that?
Yes, well, that is a very big question. But thank you, first of all, for inviting me here, for the lovely introduction. It's very difficult to step back from one's own time and look at it historically. I found that very challenging when I wrote The Rest is Noise, because everything seemed very clear at a certain distance, though of course not uncomplicated, when I was looking at the early 20th century, or even the mid-20th century. But once I got to the end of the century, and I did start working on the book around 1999, 2000, so the century was just expiring as I set to work, it was very difficult to step back. And looking at the book now, I think I would look at that period at the very end of the century quite differently, because the ground is always shifting under your feet. But I guess I could make a stab at it. We've obviously been having this conversation about the precarious state of classical music really my whole adult life. I've been hearing some version of it for another, and I'm coming up on 50, so it has been going on for a while. And then, if you look back historically, all through the 20th century, there were worries about the future of this art form. Or even going back to earlier centuries. If you look at the history of opera in Venice in the 17th century, there were editorials, commentaries saying this art form is in decline, the great age is past, financial problems, all these kinds of struggles.
Subscriptions are down.
So this sense of precariousness it almost seems to be inherent in the art form. It was Charles Rosen who said that the death of classical music is its oldest continuing tradition, or words to that effect. And yet, that's no reason to dismiss the problems that we have and to say, oh, this is somehow going to fix itself because we're still here and there's always been this fear of the future. And I think there are very real problems. I suppose I would say that some of our bigger institutions do seem to be facing some very serious questions, and I would be surprised if they were still all here 20 or 30 years from now. It's very hazardous to make predictions, and as a journalist, I try to shy away from it altogether, because it can distort your point of view. If you make a prediction, then you sort of look for the evidence to that it's coming true. Mm-hmm. On the one hand, I think there are some major questions about our bigger institutions, and at the same time, I'm tremendously optimistic about the general state of music. Just the new music, what composers are doing, I think, is just extraordinarily exciting and diverse at present. Smaller ensembles, I think there's sort of at once a sense of danger and enormous opportunity and excitement. Mm-hmm. I think it's a complex mixture of feelings that I have looking around the classical music scene, and a lot of it has to do with just the size of the organization and its history and its sense of direction. I think it all comes down to a particular organization and a particular place. I think the state of classical music globally is something you simply cannot make generalizations about, because it's so varied from city to city, from state to state, and from country to country. I think you find very different factors at work. Mm-hmm.
So when you think about the future of it, then, I think we would probably agree that the future is not exclusively in the large opera houses or on the symphonic stages. Where is the future I mean, what is interesting? I agree with you, but what to you is interesting and exciting about that future? What does that look like, you know, in terms of venue, in terms of content, what the artist is doing?
Well, I think one revolution has occurred is that composers especially are creating works that do not require a particular venue, or certainly do not require a traditional venue. And this is sort of this has tremendously expanded the scope of where they can be played, and therefore the audience that can come to see them. I'm obsessed with new music. It's sort of at the heart of what I do. So my perspective on these questions is distorted by that bias, but I don't think it's a flawed bias. I think you know, as Alan Gilbert said not long ago at the New York Philharmonic, what composers are doing is the most important thing that's happening in the art form at any given time. And what struck me about that statement is that it sounds like a somewhat radical thing for the conductor of a big orchestra to say, but why should it be radical? You know, if in the visual arts we were having a discussion of the state of contemporary art and a leading curator or head of a museum or what have you were to say what artists are doing at any given time is the most important thing happening in the art form, mm-hmm. that would be a sort of ludicrously obvious thing to say. Well, mm-hmm. of course. Mm-hmm. But in classical music, no, because of the omnipresence, because of the overbearing presence of our past, it still feels radical to focus on the new. So for me, this is the ongoing project. I feel as though I've seen a lot of progress in my own adult life observing this scene, but there's still so much progress to be made in terms of shifting the emphasis to new work without, of course, losing hold of the greatness of the past. But that, for me, that is the future, and that is the answer to all of our problems.
So when you think about the 20th century, I'm coming back to your book, and this is interesting, the subject of contemporary music, and it interests me a lot as well. And I guess the question I would ask is, so did we get into trouble in the middle of the 20th century with the narrowness of what was acceptable for quote-unquote serious composers to be writing, the styles that they were supposed to write in? I mean, I love 12-tone music, but did the stylistic rigidity, in some sense, is not typical of what we see with composers today? I think we see an opening up of composers' styles. And what's your take? What's your view of that?
I actually don't think so. Something did go wrong in the 20th century in terms of the relationship between composers and the public, but I'm not inclined to blame the composers themselves and to say that they went too far out in the direction of the avant-garde in writing music that the mainstream found unpalatable, and therefore there was some kind of growing division between audiences and new music, and therefore too much concentration on the art of the past. There are several problems with that general point of view, which is not to say that there weren't some extreme cases of composers essentially asking subscribers at a particular symphony orchestra to just, you know, take in more than they were really able to do, and mm-hmm. not giving particularly clear explanations mm-hmm. of what they were doing. Mm-hmm. You know, certainly there are cases of that. But there's a much older problem, and I think something I've talked about it many, many times, and I'm going to continue talking about it at the risk becoming a sort of walking cliche, but if you look at programming in the 19th century, over the course of the 19th century, you see a steady increase in in the music of the past, and the music of no longer living composers. And you can chart this. William Weber has written a wonderful book telling this story and including very clear charts showing it happening in Leipzig, in Paris, in various places. It's just this steady upward ascent of the percentage of no longer living composers on programs from the area of 20-25% or even lower toward the beginning of the 19th century to 75-80 even higher percent by the last part of the 19th century. So something is happening there which does not have very much to do with what composers are writing, because in the latter half of the 19th century, you have Verdi, Wagner, Tchaikovsky, Brahms. You have composers who had, in their own lifetimes, a tremendous sense of connection to the public, and of course, even more so today. And yet something was happening. Audiences were becoming mesmerized by the music of the past to the exclusion of the music of the present. And that was a troubling development, and I think it's a syndrome built deep into classical music culture, the attitudes of audiences, the architecture of concert halls, the sense of concert halls being shrines to the past as opposed to laboratories of the present. I think various cultural and psychological factors at work. But by the end of the 19th century, before Schoenberg, atonality, and the 20th century avant-garde, before all that happened, audiences were already resisting the music mm-hmm. of the present, or simply too preoccupied with the music of the past to pay sufficient attention to the music of the present. So something had already gone wrong mm-hmm. before the 20th century began. Mm-hmm. And then when you look at the 20th century, I mean, it's a fantastically diverse body of work. And you know, at no time were 12-tone composers and avant-garde composers excluding all these other voices. You know, in the 50s and 60s, you had Giancarlo Menotti and Bernstein and the American School of Symphonic Composers. You had a tremendous number of people writing in a more or less tonal idiom, as well as all those other composers working in a more advanced idiom. So it was always diverse. The 20th century was always this tremendous mix of musical languages, always proliferating, and it remains so today. I mean, everything that surfaced and was invented in the 20th century is still alive now and being extended, and then you have composers right now who are really coming up with completely new ideas. I think the challenge with new music is simply the overwhelming diversity of it. You can't boil that down. You can't say, like, here's what's happening and here are the three people who are doing it well. You know, it's far more complicated than that. But that, for me, that also makes it tremendously exciting. Mm-hmm. You know, that you know, as an audience member, as a listener, I tell people, you can find the music that you love. It's out there. You simply have to search a little for it.
Mm-hmm. So if you, I know that you don't write primarily on popular music, although you have from time to time. And I think I read in your blog that I read some comments on a Prince concert you had seen. Yeah, I think you wrote it shortly after his death. Mm-hmm. And so I guess I my question is, how you see pop music today, and what's your view of the separation of classical music from pop music? Because it does go partly to what you're talking about, you know, back in the 19th century, where that gets separated. Mm-hmm. And who got the worst end of the deal? And what's your view of that? And do you see some of the crossover that we see today, that coming back together?
Well, this is also a very complicated question. If we're talking about, the big question with 20th century music is why did it turn out so differently from, say, the story of 20th century art, visual arts, or 20th century literature. You know, why is it that hundreds of thousands of people, millions of people, mob museums when it's an exhibition of Picasso or Kandinsky or Jackson Pollock very avant-garde artists of recent years in the present day? You know, why is there this unbelievable hysteria and vast sums of money being spent in the art market on often extremely radical and, to me, as a kind of, you know, outsider Philistine in that world, incomprehensible contemporary art? You know, why are sort of all the equivalent personalities and artists in 20th century music and contemporary music so much more obscure so much more difficult, you know, for the average person to assimilate? And this is a conversation that people have in the new music world all the time, and no one has really come up with the definitive good answer. I think there are a number of factors at work. People often talk about just the medium of music, how we listen, the physicality of sound, how it does physically enter us and affect us very directly in a way that an image on a wall or a text on a page does not. The social aspect of concert going, the fact that in any given concert presenting something quite new, you have a crowd of people who are being forced to endure a particular presentation together over an extended duration, and it creates a potential mob situation that can go quite wrong. Whereas in a museum, people find their own path. You can look at something for 10 seconds and like that. And then on your way out of the gallery, you look at it again, and you look at it for another 20 seconds. And, maybe there's something there. And you can sort of develop a relationship with the work at your own pace. And that is really not possible, especially in the live concert situation.
Can we learn something from that in terms of how
you... Well, then you have this aspect of, well, then what about recordings? You know, so all this music is on recording, and you can... listen to a bit of it, reject it, and then come back later and suddenly find it interesting. I mean, that's happened so many times with me. Mm-hmm. Something that I initially ignore, someone begins to speak to me strongly for whatever reason, days later or years later, who mm-hmm. knows. So these are really complicated questions, but I've drifted from your initial question about pop music. But this is another big factor. Obviously the fact that we saw the birth and development and increasing sophistication and seriousness of popular music traditions in the 20th century. This is probably the biggest factor of all. Because I look at my friends, people I went to school with, went to college with, incredibly intelligent people who they'd read Proust and James Joyce, and they sort of knew the history of 20th century art very well, and they saw, go to the movie theater to see sophisticated foreign films of Tarkovsky and so on. When it came to Alban Berg and Messiaen and 20th century composers, whom I loved and sort of saw at the sort of equal level as all those artists in other arenas, it was just a blank, but they were incredibly serious about jazz, about punk rock, about Bob Dylan, about personalities in the pop music world. And it wasn't just entertainment. It was incredibly important to them. They knew the literature and the biographies and the lyrics and could have endless debates at a very sort of high aesthetic level over what was going on in that music. And so for so many people, they grew up with that music, and it fills their need for serious music and not just for entertainment music. So, and then you ask them, well, here are, you know, here are 750 composers, you know, in the classical tradition from the 20th century that you should also be paying attention to, and it is difficult to, mm-hmm. to persuade them to take in all that new information. So that's a major obstacle. And yet, you know, what I've found is that the borderline, the various borderlines between popular music and classical music can become thresholds that people can cross and sort of find their way in. You don't need to start with Bach or Mozart or Beethoven. You can start at the latter end. You can start with Steve Reich or Stockhausen or Cage. You know, I discovered in college that this was actually my way into popular music, was crossing this kind of avant-garde border between genres. Because I grew up, I was completely immersed in classical music from a very early age and listened to absolutely nothing else until I was basically 18 years old, which made me tremendously...
You're a freak.
I was tremendously popular in high school. literally nothing. And even, and it was a big step when I started listening to, you know, Berg and Bartok and you know, Mahler and Sibelius when I was 16 or 17. That felt very rebellious, you know. but then I started, you know, following the 20th century decade by decade, especially when I was in college and I had a radio show and I was just devouring the 20th century and all its manifestations. I became so excited by it and so immersed in it. And you know, by the time I was in the 50s, 60s, and 70s, and listening to Xenakis and Stockhausen and Ligeti, I was actually at a point where I could then listen to free jazz, Ornette Coleman and Cecil Taylor. You know, friends of mine would hear this crazy music I was playing from the sort of classical avant-garde and say, you should listen to you know, our crazy music that actually sounds remarkably alike at certain moments. And that was where I crossed over. You know, this was the first quote-unquote popular music I listened to was Cecil Taylor and rock bands like Per Ubu and Sonic Youth, a very sort of noisy, dissonant end of post-punk rock. And then I started slowly discovering the whole rest of pop music. But you know, people just you know take that same route in the opposite direction, and a lot of my friends kind of discovered, or you know they're listening to David Bowie and Brian Eno, and they discover Steve Reich and Philip Glass, and they sort of take them the minimalist route, you know, the various routes in, or the earlier crossover points between you know jazz and classical music in the 20s and 30s, and so those relationships are incredibly valuable, and I think performers and institutions should emphasize them as much as possible. You know, in terms of crossover, in terms of actually trying to combine those musics together, that's very tricky. It can easily go wrong. it can also produce tremendously satisfying results. But obviously, it's a very active area right now, where you sort of see people in the indie rock and indie pop world writing classical pieces, and likewise, younger classical composers collaborating with pop artists, you know, involving themselves in some way with pop music. So there is a very strong interchange right now, which is certainly worth keeping an eye on and developing as much.
Yeah, because it really does go both ways there.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, with the artists. So so maybe that's a good segue also to. You know, as we think about where music is going and what composers are doing and what will happen in classical music, so do you think the demands on artists and musicians are different today? And if so, how? And if you were, because we're a school, you know, I'm interested in this question. I'm interested in, if you were training musicians today, what would you do?
Well, the demands on everyone are different. I mean, as a writer, you know, 20, 25 years ago when I was starting out, I wrote the piece, I sent it to my editor, and hopefully it was, you know, printed more or less intact, and that was it, you know. And I'd, you know, call a few friends on the telephone, I have a piece, you know, in the magazine this week, you know. You know, now, of course, there's this whole other dimension to what I do in terms of, first of all, the internet and writing directly for the internet has for some time been a considerable portion of what I do, and that's it's a different kind of writing and a different kind of mechanism. But then there's this whole business of you know, helping to launch your piece out into the world and social media and this expectation that basically every writer has to do something to sort of, you know, push the work along, and the question of sort of how it's going to be, you know, packaged and presented in the social media arena. It doesn't exist. It's not actually, even especially just in the past 5 years, it's become much more of a factor. And it's exactly the same with musicians. It's simply not enough to learn the piece and play it, or to compose the piece and you know, find some performers to play it and eventually hopefully get it published. You know, there's so much more work to be done. Some of it feels essential and may not be essential, and you know, especially with the social media stuff, you know, I just wonder, is this just like a total waste of time? And yet, obviously, it does have a power, kind of a serendipitous power, to you know, put your work out to a larger audience. And I think I was, with my first book, I was tremendously lucky, really without planning it, to have started blogging in 2004. At around the time that blogging was having some kind of heyday, it's now considered, it is now sort of in decline, like so many everything else. But I sort of caught a certain wave, and I found a modest following for what I was writing on my blog, and I think that helped to launch my book into the world. As I talked about my book in progress on the blog, people became interested in it and were just sort of looking forward to it. And, you know, getting a book into the world is you know, an incredible challenge in itself with its own peculiar demands. So yes, I mean, for all of us, for everyone, trying to insert some piece of creative work into this just avalanche of information and entertainment and distraction that surrounds us all the time. There's all these extra steps, and it's just this constant negotiation. Some of it is necessary, and it can have tremendous power, but it can also eat into your time and distract you from the sort of primary creative work. And so that's just honestly a day-to-day, hour-to-hour struggle that I have with all of these media and all of these distractions. And I do often wonder, are we ultimately better off
well, I mean, with would all you, of this? Would you say, though, that ultimately in the way your job has changed, that and I would probably make the same parallel to a musician's job, that you have become, in a sense, partly responsible in a more proactive way for cultivating your audience?
Yes, absolutely. Yeah, I think just, you know, again, looking at my own work as a writer, I just never worried about any of these things when I started out. It was just my responsibility was to get the verbiage to my editor, and that was that. And now somehow we're all expected to participate in the you know, amplification of the work into the general arena. And I think that's just even more the case for performing musicians and for composers and for everyone else. And I think, I mean, a lot of it has to do with the decay of institutions, the sense of sort of the weakening power of institutions, and the sense that it's just more and more up to the individual to make sure that the work gets out there into the world. You can just sort of no longer trust the institution to do that work for you. And yet, institutions, I think, you know, I'm infinitely grateful to be at the New Yorker, which is an institution with a great history and is in reasonably good health and is is an incredibly powerful platform for me to be, you know, placing my work on. Mm-hmm. You know, it's, I could not, you know, I would not, none of this would have happened without the New Yorker. The books and the rest is noise, and it all comes back to that magazine and the podium that magazine gives me, and the excellence of the editing, mm-hmm. and everything else. Mm-hmm. And I think, and you know, for musicians, it's the same. Mm-hmm. As the institutions, as problematic as they are, as you know, difficult as their situation may be, they retain this incredible power to support your work. Mm-hmm. So we shouldn't be sort of looking to some future of every man, every woman for himself, mm-hmm. herself. It's we need institutions to sustain these traditions. Mm-hmm.
So we've been talking for a little over a half hour, so maybe it'd be a good time just to open it up and let folks start to ask. I certainly have some more questions I want to get to, but I want to engage our audience as well. So I invite you to get in on the conversation. Okay, let's start back there. Yes. Mm-hmm.
Well, I think performers and composers who are able to write well or engagingly have added a very powerful weapon to their arsenal in terms of widening the audience for their work, and it's been this way for a long time. Glenn Gould built his reputation, I think, not, you know, as much on his writing as on his performance, but the writing was a very significant factor in the sort of growth of his legend. In our own day, Jeremy Denk has established himself as a writer as well as a wonderful pianist, and that is, I think, especially for sort of non classical music specialist geek types, sort of just that broader audience, that kind of NPR audience, New Yorker readers, what have you.
Stephen Huff writes. Stephen writes.
Yeah, the articles, blogs, just to sort of give a face, a personality to their work, and a sense of its rationale, and the sense of the passion and particular interests of the artist, and of its history, and of the context. There's something to fasten onto. I mean, sort of so many people on the outside need those landmarks, that kind of roadmap, that sort of basic sense of orientation in this forbidding expanse of the, you know, 35-minute long piano sonata. And writing, I think, is just tremendously powerful in terms of sort of giving that handhold. So yeah, I would absolutely encourage people to write and to seek whatever medium can be found to, whether it's, you know, talking before a concert, writing program notes, blogs, essays on something like Medium, and sort of, you know, other platforms that are pretty open to a wide range of writers. It certainly can't do any harm, and I think in certain cases it can really trigger something with a wider audience to sort of bring them in.
I think part of it also just is all of those things, and that audiences, and I certainly saw this in the orchestra world, that they want to be close to performers. They want to know what sort of how performers think.
Exactly.
You know. Yeah.
And it seems so mysterious.
Right.
Sort of, you know. Members of this secret sect in hoods almost are sort of performing these mysterious rites, and they want to sort of get inside it. They just don't understand so many basics about music making and music history, and so writing can be very powerful that way. And this is something else is sort of rather pessimistic from my point of view, but music critics are a vanishing species. Every year another one of my colleagues or several of my colleagues lose their jobs, or the publication itself folds. So we are fewer and fewer, and there will need to be other people in the public arena talking about music, whether it's in traditional publications or sort of all these other media that are now available. And so performers that have any kind of knack for writing, as well as scholars, people in the academic world, I think will have to play an increasing role in terms of translating what we do for a wider public, because I'm much more worried about the future of, well, not just classical music criticism, but journalism itself, than I am about the future of music.
Let me ask you, Alex. So, because this is a running conversation I've had with a number of critics over the years. Do you see the role of the critic to be? Obviously, it's criticism. It's to make the audience aware and to write about what is happening, but. Is it also audience develop? I mean, is it a responsibility of the critic to help to develop the audience? Which is a delicate balance in if you're covering a certain beat. But what do you think about that?
It's not an essential duty. If a particular critic simply does not want to think of their work in those terms, that's absolutely fine. That people should write what comes to them. Comfortably and naturally, and yet, for me, certainly that's always been a part of it. Mm. When I think back to my college days and just the beginning of my whole kind of accidental career as a critic was in college. There was this music that I was obsessed with, and I was just trying to get people interested in it, and just my roommates. I'd put on a piece by Alban Berg. And they'd say, that just sounds like horror movie music. And they'd say, no! Yeah. And I'd start, explicating it. And then I had my radio show, and there may be at most 7 or 8 people listening at any given time. But I wrote out these laborious essays and would read them aloud in the air. And it was just people have got to pay more attention to this music that meant so much to me. And so that need, that urge to persuade, mm-hmm. to bring people aboard has been just part of my critical career from the beginning. I think that is, with every critic, whether they sort of want to admit it or not. A lot of people want to sort of have I'm just here as the fearsome neutral judge of musical excellence and I'm not an advocate, I'm not a educator. But ultimately, anyone who is in this business for any length of time has to have that enthusiasm, mm-hmm. that passion, and I've never met anyone who didn't have it in some degree, and that sort of urge to convert is going to enter into their mm-hmm. their writing. And yet, I'll say this about criticism and reviews. We're living in a moment in terms of the journalism business where reviews, in not just in classical music, in sort of all the cultural areas, are unpopular. They're unpopular with the audience, frankly. And it's so easy to measure how many given people are reading a given piece online. They can't measure what people are doing, mm-hmm. Reading the print edition of a newspaper or a magazine, but they can certainly see what they're doing online. And frankly, the reviews, in many cases, are getting vanishingly few hits. Does this mean that absolutely no one is reading? Unfortunately, they can't measure the print readership, and the print readership may have a considerable portion of older people who don't spend so much time online and who love classical music. So I think this system of measurement is biased against classical music and a lot of the more traditional art forms. But all that aside, that's the mm-hmm. situation. And so editors are saying to a lot of my colleagues, no, we don't want you to review so much. You know, it's sort of write more kind of opinion pieces and sort of the kind of hot take on such and such a topic, profiles, conversations, debates. And that's great. But the review, I think, remains essential to what we do. Mm-hmm. I actually, it's the part of the process that in many ways interests me least. Just this kind of final judgment, sort of thumbs up, thumbs down, evaluating the performances. I'm always reluctant about that sort of aspect of the job. And you know, The New Yorker, my columns have always been a combination of review elements and essayistic elements. And putting, you know, giving a context for the music and a wider picture that tends to excite me more. But that reviewing aspect, it is essential, and I think the business needs it. You know, even if most performers really don't like it at all, I think it is very important to have a critical dimension. Where people, it's where you sort of put yourself out, you know, on the line, and sort of, you know, put your cards on the table when you write the review, and so if you take that away, suddenly the job of the critic becomes something much more vaporous. Like, what am I doing here? I'm sort of chatting and you know, giving opinions and previewing and profiling, and it loses the element of
what really happened in the performance.
Yes,
yeah.
The journalistic aspect. And even though it's so subjective and people will have such differing opinions on what actually happened in the performance, mm-hmm. nonetheless, it's important for us to be there, you know, putting that on paper.
Yeah.
So that concerns me, but that's a question for journalism and not for performance so much.
Take another question, lots of them back row there.
Thank you for being here. At different times, you've written about the intersection of politics and music, and one of the notable writings of yours that spoke to me some was your reaction to Jet being included in a list of people killing music by Jet Pearl in As If Music Could Do No Harm.
Uh-huh.
And in that, you write, art does not stand apart from reality. If it did, it would have no life in it, no light, no darkness, no power. I was wondering if you could speak to what you see happening in the relationship between music and politics, and what that might look like in 2017.
Whatever made you ask that question?
I don't know, is something going on?
Yeah, must be.
Well, yeah, I mean, I'm working right now on another piece on that theme. And I'm sure a lot of people are asking themselves, what's the point? And when the world looks so chaotic, when the news is so unsettling for so many people, when you may have a government in charge of your country that you don't believe in and seems to be going on an absolutely wrong path, What's the point of learning a Bach piece or writing about a performance of a Bach piece, or even something more contemporary? It can seem futile and beside the point. So I've been asking myself that question. Of course, I hear a lot of people, performers, composers, and so on, asking that question. You know, what do we do? If we're being overwhelmed by political convictions right now, does that have to be now front and center? Do we have to sort of abandon the routine and commit ourselves to a much more political way of working? And this is just, it's a question that I don't have any answer to. It's something that I think about all the time. First of all, I mean, art can't separate itself from reality, from the contemporary political reality, as I said in that piece. You cannot draw a line. So, you know, a performance of Bach's St. John Passion is actually going to have an enormous, immediate, visceral impact on what everyone in the audience is feeling and thinking about at that moment, as well as all of the performers, even more so than ever. And you know, setting aside everything I've said about the excessive preoccupation with the past in classical music, it is startling and extraordinary how these works that are hundreds of years old can acquire a relevance that you can't control. You know, you can sort of say, I'm going out here and I'm performing this work with, you know, such and such a sort of emotion in mind. Some people in the audience may tune into exactly that same wavelength. Other people may have some completely unexpected reaction. Some people may be moved in a way that you would find offensive if you could, you know, sort of figure out what they were thinking. You can't control it, but nonetheless, it will have that immediate present tense power. And I certainly felt that the sort of October, November, I was working on a piece for the New Yorker about Bach's St. John Passion, it could not have been more acutely relevant to every extreme emotion I was feeling. So I guess the end point of all this would be that, you know, people should do what comes, you know, naturally to them. And if you're the kind of composer who writes numbered string quartets, or a painter who specializes in abstractions with abstract titles, and that is your strength, and that's what you thrive on. You know, no one should feel this pressure to you know, essentially reject their destiny and go in some completely new direction. If you have a flair for you know, composing pieces that do have political messages, or if you can write effectively in a way that connects the music of the past to the politics of the present, you should continue doing this. And this and this is your hour, in a sense. But ultimately, you know, art's variety and the passion that artists invest into, you know, whatever they do, well, hopefully it will make a difference. I think this is just, it's a problem for each one of us to solve, and something that, you know, that I struggle with from day to day. But yeah, I feel in my own work, you know, do I need to, you know, make my particular column this week more relevant or not? It's just a sort of case by case decision and struggle.
So, but you wrote this column, the Frankfurt School knew Trump was coming.
Mm-hmm.
And you talk about the resurgence of authoritarianism, akin to McCarthyism. And then you made an interesting comment where you called Germany the strongest living bastion of democracy, and in which you start, and the article is about Thomas Mann and of course the escape from the Nazis and came to the United States. But what I think you're saying is that essentially the United States and Germany are crossing here, where Germany is actually emerging as the you seem to be implying is the leading defender of democracy, and maybe the United States not so much. So I guess what I want, let's assume for a second your premise is correct. Just assume for a second. I'm not saying
we'll
it
see
is.
What
I'm
happens
not saying it is, and we'll see what happens.
Next German election.
But right, yeah. But what's the so? But the question I want to ask you is, what's the role of the musician or the citizen artist in all of that? And you also make a comment in your book. I think you said this. Correct me if I'm wrong. That when you're talking about Shostakovich, you were talking about the whole Shostakovich business and Prokofiev and Stalin, and I think you said they failed to rise up. Composers failed to rise up.
So what is the role of the creative artist in all of this?
Well, it's very difficult. You know, a lot of my work has been focused on this question of how composers and performers behaved in the 20th century under authoritarian and totalitarian regimes. Obviously, two big chapters of my book were focused on that. I was here in this hall 2006 giving a lecture based on the book that I was in the process of finishing at that time. And it's a constant conversation. It's something that people constantly debate. What did Wilhelm Furtwängler do? What should he have done? What would we have done? Should Richard Strauss have left Germany in 1933? Should Dmitri Shostakovich have given or not given such and such a speech? So this has been endlessly debated. And everyone has had morally secure judgments on these questions. And yet, here we are at a moment in American history where the future of democracy does not seem at all secure. When I wrote that piece in the fall, I hoped that it would come to be seen as a hysterical overreaction. And I still hope it will. But we are at a crossroads, and so now the question is, how will each of us mm-hmm. act? Mm-hmm. Will we compromise ourselves? Will we speak out? It's an incredibly difficult thing to confront. I just never conceived that in my lifetime. Such questions would come to the fore in this country, but again, you know, the responsibilities, the duties of artists, it's just not something we can make laws about and deliver sort of absolutely black and white judgments about. Shostakovich. That music that Shostakovich wrote played such a complex and ambiguous role mm-hmm. in the Soviet Union, where on the one hand it seemed to be fulfilling an official role, and at the same time it had an alternative meaning for a very wide audience. But that was obviously not something that Shostakovich himself found great contentment mm-hmm. and satisfaction in. It was a constant agony mm-hmm. For him, mm-hmm. and I think that same sort of agony is what we face. But these are very fraught mm-hmm. Questions. But it's just important to mm-hmm. to confront them and to just not to lapse. And this is just not the time to lapse into routine and to sort of go on and continue as we did before. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. There needs to be some kind of some sense of rededication mm-hmm. in whatever we do.
Mm-hmm. Okay, over here.
What is something that you wish someone told you about the book writing process before writing your first book?
Well, it's very, very difficult. It's a very, very difficult process. I don't know if there's anything that anyone could have told me that would have made it easier, because I needed to go through this. It turned out that essentially I needed to write far more. The first draft of the book was twice as long as as the published version, and I just had to do that in order to sort of find the book. I mean, I sort of produced this massive verbiage, and then I went back, and as I cut and rewrote, a kind of, you know, the book itself emerged. And you know, I wish I could have avoided that, and I wish someone had just said, just don't let the chapter go beyond X thousand words, or you'll be wasting your time. But I think I don't think it would have been the same book, and maybe not. You know, I don't know how it would have turned out. And now I'm making the exact same mistake because I've written about 2/3 of this book called Wagnerism, and it's way, way too long, and all the chapters are going on for just, you know, thousands and thousands of words, and yet I know this is necessary. Again, I'm finding the heart of what it is that I'm looking for, and so it's. You know, the path to writing a book, I think, is just different for each person. I think what I discovered, and maybe would have been helpful to hear right at the beginning, was it's like a construction project. It's like putting one brick on top of another, and on any given day, it looks just like a pile of bricks. It looks like nothing, and you're just sort of, and there's sort of a whole series of sentences you write that feel just banal and you know, devoid of style or interest. But the important thing is just to keep the wall rising brick by brick, and eventually you go back and you realize, hey, this isn't so bad. These sort of bland, kind of straightforward sentences are just what is needed to sort of, you know, pull the narrative along. I had to abandon this mode of writing that I practice with the magazine pieces, where I actually spend a huge amount of time fussing with the very beginning of the piece, and I'll spend day after day just sort of trying to find just the right opening sentence, an opening paragraph, and I won't be able to sort of get into the remainder of the piece until I've solved that problem. Mm-hmm. And it's, you know, I want to have the opening that sort of pulls the reader in, that sort of snags their attention. This is not necessary in the beginning of chapter 7 of a book. You know, if they're that far along, you don't need to like wave your arms and catch their attention. In fact, it can be exhausting to read a book that is sort of performing these sorts of, you know, rhetorical gestures, you know, time and again from chapter to chapter. So I think that would have been helpful for someone to say, this style of writing that you've practiced in the magazine and journalistic work is, you'll need to evolve. You'll need to find something different. You'll need to find a book style, because I think I did waste a certain amount of time with a more, you know, journalistic style of writing that just proved ultimately not to work. A book, it just has a voice of its own, and each, in a strange way, each book has a mind of its own. It becomes a kind of being. This sounds crazy to say, but it's sort of this sort of being with its own consciousness that you're just kind of, you know, helping to emerge. I feel like at a certain point you almost lose control. It has a kind of momentum, it sort of gathers some kind of momentum, but that sounds like I'm losing my mind.
No, that's interesting. That's interesting. Let's see. Let's take one over here. We had one over here.
I was wondering if, after writing a few books, the discoveries that you made while working or evolving your book writing then kind of came back and impacted your journalistic writing.
Oh, definitely. Yeah. I mean, it already is. This working on this book, I find myself becoming fascinated by a particular figure. I wrote a piece about Stefan Mallarmé for the magazine last year, the great, somewhat inscrutable, yet wonderful symbolist poet. And this was initially it was a section of my book devoted to French Wagnerism, this amazing phenomenon from the 1860s. Through the end of the 19th century, and actually well into the 20th, of French writers engaging with Wagner and finding something in Wagner which no one else was hearing, and beginning with Baudelaire and so many of the great symbolist writers. So I wrote this little section on Mallarmé for the chapter, but you know, having spent a whole summer basically staring at these Mallarmé poems and trying to figure out, you know, A, what they might mean, and B, what I would try to say about them, I wanted to say more, and so it became a piece for the New Yorker, which is just a tremendously lucky thing that I have this place of employment, a magazine that lets me pursue my own fascinations and passions in that way. So, the work on the book ends up sort of leading my magazine writing in new directions, with the rest is noise. There was actually much more kind of integration between what I was doing in the magazine and pieces of the book as they came together. I wrote a whole series of pieces about 20th century composers, and also a couple of pieces on these sort of larger themes of politics and music in the 20th century. With the Wagnerism project, I just can't, write another Wagner piece every few months for the magazine. But it's in sort of more indirect ways, I think it is leading to new work for the magazine, which is very exciting.
Wonderful. Let's see, Mark.
Thank you. Thank you for being here. A while back, Fred asked you something like, where did we go wrong in the last century? I'm not sure if it was in response to that or another question, but you mentioned intellectual friends who knew not only the music, but the biography of people like Bob Dylan. Mm-hmm. I'm thinking of how incredibly transformational the 60s and 70s were to a number of things, including popular music, and at a time when there was so much political unrest, similar to today, possibly. But did, quote, serious music miss the boat?
It might well have. Yeah, I mean, if you think of how many popular artists in that period, first of all, brought this kind of new dimension of complexity to their work, whether it's Dylan's lyrics in the tradition of beat poetry, not to mention Rimbaud and older writers. Or the sort of layers of sound in Beatles songs and various other bands that they just enriched and made the texture of their music so much more interesting. At the same time, they're the very strong political engagement. Just the rock music in the late 60s just seemed to matter far more than whatever classical composers were doing. And of course there were a great many politically engaged composers in that period and composers who were working with very contemporary themes and very contemporary media, but somehow that moment in rock music it just seized the attention of a generation in a very dramatic way. And that's actually when in the history of classical music in America, it's really when you see people becoming preoccupied by the aging of the audience, and just suddenly people weren't seeing as many younger people at concerts. And I think that may have been a related phenomenon as well. So, here we are at another moment of great, political unrest and protest. And perhaps there is an opportunity for classical musicians and composers to seize that moment against a backdrop of a popular culture that seems to me, and I've written about this a couple of times, the previous article about the Frankfurt School a couple of years ago, and pop culture, a pop culture that is now very much the establishment. It is the elite. No one in the world of popular culture likes to be seen as the elite. Classical music is supposedly the elite. But this is the music that is enmeshed with the corporate economy. Figures of power use pop music and not classical music to buttress their message and to convey their populist appeal. Trump played Rolling Stones songs at his rallies. He also played a little bit of Pavarotti singing Nessun Dorma, but which the Pavarotti family asked him to stop doing. But the pop music was the essential aspect there, just as Reagan used Bruce Springsteen, Born in the USA. Yeah. Uh, so So pop culture, pop music, and power are meshed together. Classical music, standing on the outside to a great extent, despite the fact, of course, that, that wealthy people and corporations support our biggest institutions. I think there is an opportunity to use our work to present an alternative vision and to become a site of implicit or explicit protest, not just against Trump, the particular politics, but against this mixture of pop culture and social media and the internet and this fabric of information and distraction, which I think so many people are just trying to find a way out of, sort of fight their way out of the grip of this whole kind of fabric that sort of saturates us. And I think Stephen Schick wrote a wonderful piece about he had a concert on Inauguration Day, and he was saying this work that is complex, that asks more of its audience, that doesn't deliver a message in 140 characters or less, can become a site of opposition in some way, whether it's explicit or not. So mm-hmm. I think that's something that we in classical music as the outsiders, I mean, there's a power mm-hmm. in being on the outside. Mm-hmm. It's not just a disadvantage, a problem that we have to overcome.
Mm-hmm. Let's see. Let's go back over here.
So you said that you talked about how institutions are very important, and I totally agree. But I am wondering, it rang a little empty for me because, so I'm a performer and I've been out of music school for several years now, and the institutions as these monoliths don't really have anything to do with what I do and what a lot of people I know are doing. And the institutions also don't really represent like the diversity of the arts world and that sort of thing. So I'm wondering, and this actually is probably a question for both of you, I'm wondering what role you see the institutions playing sort of on the ground with music that's happening, and also if you see changes happening within the institutions.
I mean, I totally agree. It is so much of what's just exciting and new and essential and radical in contemporary music, performance, composition, whatever, is happening outside the institutions. Really the majority of it. I guess when I said that, I was saying, let's not take that attitude so far that we see institutions as dispensable, because in a sense, that kind of radical work on the edge defines itself against the institutions. And just in terms of maintaining the traditions, there's this whole magnificent body of work that can't really be performed outside of traditional concert halls and opera houses. You just can't take a Mahler symphony and put it in a warehouse. It's just not going to sound right. We need the institutions to sustain the tradition and to preserve a mode of employment, which is sort of is so important for thousands and thousands of people in this country. This is really where in terms of what's happening in new music, especially, it's works for smaller ensembles, it's music theater as opposed to full-scale grand opera, it's sort of mixing live and electronic elements, it's sort of moving in the direction of genres that we don't even really have a name for yet. Two nights ago, I saw Kate Soper's new work in New York, Ipsa Dixit, and there is no name for what she's doing. You just have to go watch it. Mm-hmm. it's some form of music theater, but I don't think it's like anything we've really seen before. And so, do you want to?
Yeah, no. I mean, I think that I agree. I think the institutions tend to be far behind, actually, that you know what really happens. And I think whether you're talking about performing arts institutions or schools. And I think that our obligation is to what we can do in a school, and we are starting to do this here, and we will do it, is to say that we have to turn out artists that are capable of moving into that environment rather than just a traditional environment. Because even if you go into the traditional environment isn't traditional anymore. It's increasingly less so. So the answer is yes, and we have to change that in what happens here.
Yeah, and ideally institutions would evolve in a direction where, you know, as Ernest Fleischmann used to speak of the community of musicians, an orchestra would be this ensemble that can come together to perform Beethoven and Mahler, but can also split up into units that can go in very different directions and present, you know, a very different kind of work that doesn't feel institutional at all, but the sort of institution is the umbrella, you know, under which so many different kinds of expression can flourish. But we're nowhere near that. You know, the LA Philharmonic has long been a model. That's where Ernest Fleischmann conceived that concept. But you know, even they have only gone a little way. So there's a great deal more ground to be covered.
Mm-hmm. Okay, another question. Let's come back here.
I'm wondering.
Actually, I had her, but we'll do you, and then we'll go to you. Okay.
I'm wondering, since you're writing this new book on Wagner, one thing I like to talk to people about and like, you know, contemplate is Wagner's music is so incredibly beautiful and amazing and inspirational, but some of his writings aren't. Some of his writings are. I love, you know, the complete work of art and things like that, but some of his writings, like Judaism and Music, is very, very not inspirational. And so I'm wondering, either in your book or personally, how, and with other artists too, should we or should we not, and how do we reconcile the person with the musician and with the music that comes out of the person?
Yeah, I think that's something we confront in the biographies of so many artists. I mean, Wagner is the most spectacular and dismaying case, I think. But you know, there's a nasty side to so many of these composers that we place on pedestals and sort of create a saintly aura around, and it's something that I've always put forward in my work. Certainly not emphasized it to the exclusion of everything else, but you know, never to neglect that side of a particular artist that is unattractive. When I wrote about Bach, I felt it was absolutely necessary to confront the very uncomfortable question of the possible anti-Semitic implications of the texts of his Passions and certain of the cantatas. It's there. You know, just the question is, you know, how do we react to it? And we just cannot answer the question of what he himself thought. There's just no direct evidence of that. But we just this needs to be part of the picture because it's a mistake to place these figures on pedestals. We need to, you know, when art goes too far in the direction of religion, of religious worship, things can go terribly wrong, as happened with Wagner and Germany in the late 19th, early 20th century. So we need to see these figures as human, as flawed. And frankly, we can understand them better, and I think we can produce more complete and emotionally rich performances, and also have richer experiences as listeners if we keep those that darker side, the darker side of music, in mind. Mm. You know, with Wagner, I feel we've almost gone a little too far in the direction of of bearing the darker side of Wagner in mind, to the point where you know, just if you ask the average educated person, who was Wagner, what did he mean, you'll probably get the answer, he was Hitler's favorite composer, you know, he has something to do with Nazism and the Holocaust. And to define Wagner completely in that way is to omit a vast spectrum of, you know, not only what he himself thought and wrote, but the effect that his music had on a huge spectrum of artists in other fields, intellectuals, politicians, and so on. So with my project with the book is to restore this enormous confusion, essentially, about, you know, what does Wagner mean? What did he mean to people? And so I will talk about his effect on communists, socialists, feminists, early advocates for gay rights in Germany, sort of good old American Democrats, occultists, Rosicrucians, theosophists. It just goes on and on and on. There's simply sort of no sector of society and culture that was not affected by Wagner in some way, especially at the turn of the last century. And the German right wing, extreme nationalist movement, the anti-Semitic movements leading to Hitler. And the tragedy, I mean, the tragedy of Wagner is partly through his own doing, his work that had such a vast kind of almost Shakespearean richness of meaning to so many people at the end of the 19th century became more and more narrowed in terms of how it was understood. And so it is to some extent his own fault, and yet I think we can try to restore the richness of the picture. But yes, we can't brush, we can't airbrush the darker side of the picture away. We should always confront it, and I think we can you know, enrich our own artistic experiences in doing so. Even with Wagner.
Hi, I wanted to pick your brain about something you brought up earlier, which was walking in and out of the gallery and your experience of art in time. And the concert going experience is something that is, it's a teleological thing. You have to sit there and the experience is the entire span of time. And you also touched on sort of this culture of instant gratification, like very attention deficit, always negotiating what you're thinking about next. Mm-hmm. And I kind of just wanted to pick your brain about how the concert-going experience, like how do we preserve that? How does it evolve in today's time?
Right. Well, one function of the concert experience can be to take a break from that constant stream of tweets and Facebook updates and texts and emails, and to create a space which is almost a sort of secular and yet quasi-sacred space. Church without the rituals, where a work of longer duration becomes the focus of your entire attention, and that this can have a sort of reorienting and kind of stabilizing and deepening effect on just your position in the world on any given day. And I've felt that many times, just sort of walking into a concert hall and just sort of having the chatter, the kind of, you know, nonsense ebb away, and to have a single work in front of me absorbing my entire attention. So I think concert halls and institutions can almost make, you know, stress that aspect of the experience further, you know, without making it seem like an overbearing ritual with codes of conduct attached. And of course, that's been a problem with classical music presentation for a long time. To sort of frame it in a different way. You know, not that, you know, you're not supposed to act this way. You should act, you know, rather, you know, here's an opportunity to sort of, you know, move into a different plane of attention and experience. And I think that can be, you know, I mean, I know a lot of institutions are sort of trying to go in a very different direction and saying, like, you can bring your, you know, tweet along with the concert, and sort of trying to dress up the experience with sort of visual dimensions and videos and so forth. That I've seen that work in certain circumstances, but I don't know. I guess I would say that institutions can somehow be trying both things at once, as contradictory as they seem. I think that, you know, social media, sort of all of this can be used to great effect in terms of marketing. It's tremendous power in terms of marketing. You know, once the aesthetic experience itself begins, I think you have to be a lot more careful in terms of how you use social media and everything else. So I guess I think that's something that sets the classical music experience apart. A largely non-electronic space where works of sort of longer duration unfold. That is very much part of what we do, and can have sort of something, can be something powerful and different for the average audience member.
Susan.
My question is really about reading, writing, and education. You mentioned writers who were performers, like, I guess I'm thinking of Charles Rosen, whose work we used to have our students read. Now, all of our undergraduates read Richard Taruskin's Oxford History, and in your acknowledgments, not only do you single him out, but you mention some other musicologists, some who have taught here and some who continue to teach here, as having helped you. In terms of what our students should be reading in order to help them write, do you have any other suggestions for us?
Well, there's so many wonderful scholars who are doing work that I think just adds so many new dimensions to, just for me, just for my understanding of particular works or composers. And I think performers should absolutely be encouraged to explore the state of, you know, musicology on any given work or any given composer. Just sort of, you know, and, you know, yes, scholarly writing can present a forbidding exterior when you first look at it, and yet there's always valuable information in terms of models for writing. In terms of my own writing, I tend not to look to sort of other writers on music so much. You know, not that I don't read them and learn a great deal from them, but just in terms of, you know, how I evolved my voice as a critic, whatever that is, for me it was very much about great literature of the 19th and 20th centuries, which is what I spent a lot of time with in college. I think surrounding yourself with writing at the highest level, a little bit of it may bleed into your work. I mean, that's always my attitude. I have a volume of the poetry of Wallace Stevens on my desk. It's been there for 25 years, and I pick it up and look at it when I'm at a loss for words, or when I'm in the middle of a sentence that feels bland and not going anywhere, and I read Wallace Stevens, and then I go back to work, and hopefully I'm not stealing from Wallace Stevens, but I sense the music of his writing. It always reminds me of the power of rhythm in language, which I think is a lot of people who don't write for a living don't think about, but there is music in prose, there is rhythm in prose. It can have a tremendous effect if you use it wisely, sparingly, I would say. So something I always say to working with students in a writing workshop, read your work aloud. Everything I write, I read aloud before sending it in, the final version, to my editor. My husband complains about this. I sound like a crazy person. But I need to read it like full voice, not just sort of muttering to myself. I need to recite it. And all kinds of things jump out at me. Poor repetitions of words. You know, you always sort of repeat more than you realize, as I have done this afternoon. Just keep saying the word tremendous over and over again. And certain words that I lean on too heavily, and they jump out at you when you read your work aloud. You hear that sentence that is just kind of rambling on too long and kind of devolving into nothing. You hear the thought that needs to be sort of tightened up, and that's just such a necessary part of the process. So for me, I surround myself with strong writerly models, and then I sort of try to make myself the first audience for my writing by reading aloud and just trying to get a little bit of a sense of how it sounds, how it reads on the page. But my editor is always much more valuable in terms of telling me, you've said this before three times, you don't need to say it again.
So we probably have time for one more question before we're out. Back there.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I just wondered, when you are doing your critical writing, do you find it difficult to separate composer's intent for the music from musician's intent from perhaps a conductor's intent?
Yeah, that's tremendously tricky. And then with opera, of course, you have the libretto and the director's intent. And to write a review of a new opera is really almost impossible to successfully separate all those factors on just one hearing. But nonetheless, I try to have that kind of frame of mind where you separate those elements and try to evaluate them as they unfold, and then sort of go back to the score itself, because it ultimately comes back to the composer and what the composer was trying to achieve, and to figure out what are the problems inherent in the work and what are the problems that might have been introduced by insufficient rehearsal, a conductor who didn't understand what the composer was trying to do, a director who took the opera in a strange direction, et cetera, it often helps in that process to have the score and to have looked at the score in advance, which I always try to do, but I can get it wrong the first time, or I can simply fail to fully appreciate what a composer was trying to do. I can also become too excited and sort of give a rave review of a piece, which 10 years later I'm like, this is not great. So it's terribly inexact, but ultimately the critic has to be true to that sort of visceral inward reaction to it. In a very strange way, you're reporting on what is happening inside of you. This also sounds insane, and yet it can be surprisingly tricky to do, to separate your own honest inward reaction from what people around you are saying, from what the reputation of this particular composer or this institution might lead you to expect, your hopes, your expectations for work from a composer you've admired in the past, or your skepticism, inherited skepticism from experiences in the past. You have to separate those external factors and just get to just honestly, what it is that you felt at that instant. Amplified, of course, by as much information as you can get from the outside. And if you write something that has integrity, that is sort of true to sort of what you felt at that time, you can feel good about it, even if 10 years later you look at it and say, like, I no longer think that way at all. I mean, I know that at least at that moment I was sort of true to what I felt. What's so distressing about this sort of decline of this profession of music critics is if you end up being in the situation where you're the only person there, it's the healthy situation is to have 9 or 10 critics chiming in with sort of all their sort of, multiple points of view. Once you become the one person left, then I think you end up becoming more guarded in what you write, more cautious, and that's not good. So that's why we need multiple critics in any given place, and then a consensus, a vague consensus begins to emerge.
So with that, I think we're going to have to leave it there. Alex, thank you for your fantastic writer.